everyone. I'm Karen and this is Emily and we're from the Philharmonia Orchestra.
And I've come to Karen's house in the country and we're going to have a lovely chat about the orchestra and our lives over a cup of tea and a piece of cake that I made this morning.
Yummy.
What's your scariest performance moment in the concert hall?
Well, there have been more than one, but I think the worst was in September 2009. And I had a two-year-old and a three-month-old and I had had no sleep. And I hadn't played the violin for a while because I just had a baby. And I decided it would be a good idea to come back and play principal for Rite of Spring for S. Pecker's installation. And so I rocked up at Watford Town Hall and there were just about 20 cameras and I was, and we had to do Rite of Spring and it was terrifying from start to finish. If you see.
But you did it.
I did it. But if you watch the footage, I mean, for starters, I look about 12. And also, you, just now and again, there's moments and you can see the terror in my eyes. There's one harmonic and that was just like, it nearly killed me every time.
Oh.
Awful. But it's fine. I love Rite of Spring. And what about you?
I think the most physically scared I've ever been was when I was in Manchester. My first job, I was in an orchestra in Manchester and I was a tutti player. And in this particular concert, I was sitting on the corner of doom, right at the back of the cello section, right on the edge of the stage, giving my own private recital to the people in the audience down at the bottom. And so we were playing, it was Brahms, the principal cellist had a massive solo. And as he was playing, I had my bow on the string and I was going like, for the whole movement. It was absolutely terrible. It was awful. I was completely frozen.
You had the hooded claw.
I had the hooded claw. Ah. And then at the end of it, this is the best bit. At the end of it, I turned to my desk partner and I said, I'm really sorry about that. And he looked at me and he said, it was beautiful.
Oh,
bless him.
I think that's something about musicians, though, that from the outside, we all look completely serene. Because I often think this about you, you look completely in control.
Always.
Completely serene.
Always. Now I am.
But underneath, we're all going...
Yeah, like the swan.
Yeah.
With the legs under the water, that's what it's like.
Yeah.
Do you have any pieces of feedback that makes you particularly proud?
Well, there was one moment, Kaz. It was on tour in the States, I think 2012, do you remember going to... With S. Pecker.
Yeah.
And we were doing Marlin 9 and Wozzeck.
Yeah.
And I was playing principal. As you know, Marlin 9 for the second violin section is a pretty big deal. And at the end of the rehearsal, I was just sitting there just playing a few bits and bobs. And S. Pecker was just walking off stage. Most people had gone and then he just suddenly stopped. And he just said, Emily, you're doing a great job. And I just, that moment stayed with me. It was great.
Oh.
Yeah, because S. Pecker, you know, he's not particularly forthcoming with praise. I mean, you know, and we all want to praise him, but.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's lovely.
It was lovely. Mm. I don't know if I ever play that well again. Right then, Karen, I'm going to be interested in this one. What's something people don't know about you as a player? I'm wondering if I'll know the answer to this question or not.
I don't know if you'll know this one. Ooh. Depends how tech savvy you are.
I'm not.
I am a GIF.
You're a GIF?
Do you know what a GIF
is?
Yes,
I do.
You know what a GIF is? I'm a GIF. If you put cello into the GIF search... And just scroll down a bit, you'll find me. And
no
you'll
way.
Find me.
Are you twirling?
Twirling my cello, yeah.
You know.
So if you ever need to say yay about something, you just send that and it's me.
Brilliant.
Yes.
I'll have to tell my children because my son still remembers coming to a concert, family concert, and seeing you twirling and just thinking it was the best thing ever. And he plays cello.
What's a common idea about your section, the second violins, right or wrong?
That's a very good question. I do wonder whether some people might think that we're inferior to first violins. I think, you know, there's like the saying, playing second fiddle or, you know, so it's sort of generally, I think people generally assume that we're less good. And I would refute that wholeheartedly. I think, so second violin parts are generally, I think fair to say, slightly simpler technically. We're often playing in the middle of the register, not high up on the E string, and we're not possibly as exposed as they are. They have a lot of tunes and we tend to be more complemental along with the viola section. But I would put across the point that actually it's very hard to play second violin really well, because being in the second violin section, the sound doesn't project as easily when you're in the middle of the instrument, the D string and the A string, which are the two middle strings. To really play very strongly there takes a lot of effort, whereas on the E string it's much brighter and you're playing up high and the sound is... And actually, as you know, with cellos and basses, when you're playing a tune in octaves, so dom, dom, so if someone's on the higher octave, the idea is that they sit in the sound of a low octave. So we need to play more strongly than the first if we're playing with them. Mm. And also, for some reason, we always seem to be two players fewer than the first violin section. I never quite understand why conductors do that. I think we should at very least be equal numbers, or possibly two more and then two less. I don't know. So that's one thing. So I think, you know, we have to work incredibly hard. We also have to be very, very flexible and listen, constantly fitting and being adaptable and taking initiative as to whether we need to be stronger there or less there. And I think we're like the engine of the orchestra along, I mean, the bass end as well. You very much give the direction, but we can shape things depending on the accompaniment. There's a wonderful quote that Sigmund Nissel, the second violin in the Amadeus Quartet, for years and years and years, gave in a BBC broadcast where he compared the string quartet to a bottle of wine. And so the first violin was the label, the cello was the bottle, and the violin, second violin and viola was the wine.
Oh, the best bit.
So, and I think that's quite relevant within the orchestra as well. So I love playing second violin. I think it's brilliant. It can be really rewarding. Do you have any favourite fun facts about the cello that you can tell us?
I do. Did you know that in the olden days, that ladies used to have to play the cello side saddle?
No way.
Yeah.
That would really screw your back.
I know.
How on earth?
I just don't know how they managed to control it.
How did you do that?
I don't know. It was more ladylike. Oh. You just play like that. And the other thing that people used to do before the invention of the spike or the end pin, people used to stand, put a cushion on a chair and stand the cello on a chair. Play behind it like that, or on a stool.
I didn't know either of those things.
There you go. It's fascinating, isn't it?
Brilliant.
I think it's better to have a spike.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As long as you...
And wear trousers.
Yeah. Have you got a favourite non-classical place that you could play and play a little bit now to us, maybe? Well, I have a little relax.
It's all right for some.
Yeah.
I like calm and I like quiet, which is probably not something that people... would immediately think about me. So I like playing quite reflective music. I do that quite a lot. And I'm going to play you a bit of Danny Boy. And another good thing about playing something quiet and calm is that it doesn't scare my cats. And they actually stay and listen sometimes. So here we go. Just try and find a hole in the floor.